we're going to get personal and intimate. Hallelujah. God, that music was good. Hallelujah. To be able to come to such a place. Everybody sober in their right mind, somewhat. And to be able to move and express any way that you want. What a gift. What a gift. Let's breathe. So full of gratitude today. So I want to know, what does freedom look like to you? What does freedom look like to you? I want to know. What does freedom look like to you? Have you ever thought about it? Have you ever dreamed about it? Have you ever prayed about it? To be free. To be free. I mean, think about financial freedom. Cup flowing over, overflowing. A divine surplus, money to share, money to spare, money to spend, money to save, money to invest, money to enjoy, and what would yours be? Yes, what does freedom look like to you? I want to know. To be wealthy. I mean, absolutely dripping in perfect health. To have a healthy, pain-free, energetic, vibrant, vital body. Healthy, fit, toned, and eternally youthful. Self-regulating, auto-adjusting mechanism called our bodies. What does freedom look like to you? In your relationships. Where the holy of most holy relationships is at its absolute best. Where there is peace and harmony in the entire family. The entire family. The entire. Where you can be fully present with every person, every moment of the day, or not. Where your relationship with you and yours, where you are both the right and perfect partner in every possible way. What would freedom look like? When you contemplate your creative genius and you think about your gifts and your talents and your passions. Oh my God, you know how you get to be, well, that's your nature? To be at one, be doing what you love, and as you allow that electrifying energy to move through you, become so aware and awake and alive to what is. That you would do it for free. What does freedom look like to you? Many of us will be consciously celebrating the observance of Martin Luther King Jr. holiday tomorrow. Yes?
Yes?
Yes, there'll be a parade. People will be in the parade. People will be on freedom trains around the world. People will be going to work at a job they were not able to have before Dr. King spoke for all of America. Yes?
Yes.
I honor and respect Dr. King. I love Dr. King. He's one of my elders, did you know? Yes, he's one of our elders. Ooh, those 20 facts were so great, weren't they? Yeah. Oh my gosh. Just everything today is on fire. I love Dr. King because he was not just a dreamer, but he lived free. You know what I mean? He was willing to sacrifice his life for what he believed in. And Dr. King believed in love. He believed that love was the tool. He believed that love was the vehicle. He believed that only love could save the soul of America. Not that some sentimental kind of love. Not that what King called an emotional bosh, that, not that kind of love, but a strong, demanding love. A love that forms the basis for nonviolence and ahimsa, do no harm. A love that is not romantic, but objective and equitable and impartial. I'm going to love you anyway. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Yes. But I'm not here to talk about Dr. King. I'm here with you, and I want to know, what does freedom look like? Well, you know, long before King ever had a dream, the birth of freedom, the idea of freedom was birthed in man's mind. It was a vision that was caught and continues to move through this field of infinite possibilities that we catch on a frequent basis. Jesus caught it. Muhammad caught it. Siddhartha caught it. Confucius caught it. Lao Tzu caught it. Haile Selassie caught it. Susan B. Anthony caught it. See, earthly power, they think that they can kill a dream by killing a dreamer.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you can't. Politicians can't stop it.
Yeah.
Economics can't stop it. Zip codes can't stop it. Guns, bullets, weapons of any kind can't stop it. Agencies can't restrict it. You can't legislate it away.
Yes.
It's already been tried.
Yes.
Love. Praise God. I said it's been caught. It's been caught. That vision of freedom has been caught by anybody who never had enough. That vision has been caught by anybody who's ever been sick and didn't have the health care or the insurance that they needed. That vision has been caught by a mother or a son or a father who's estranged from their loved one. To show up as you truly are, to be seen, to be loved, and to love. Well, you know, Ernest Holmes caught the vision. He caught the vision and he wrote it down. Hallelujah, praise God to Ernest Holmes. He wrote an essay called What We Believe. And it's our principles, what we call our principles of declaration. And these 13 stanzas give you a general idea of what we believe. But one of the stanzas says, we believe in the complete emancipation from all discord of every nature, and that this goal is sure to be attained by all. We believe. That means there's at least two people. Hey, all right? In the complete emancipation, absolute total freedom, the complete emancipation from all discord, not some, but all discord, all discord, all discord of every nature. It just ain't showing up no more. It's gone. And you are free. We believe that that is everyone's divine birthright. It is your birthright to come here and live free. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Well, our own beloved Reverend Dr. Michael Bernard Beckwith, about 40 years ago, he shared his life visioning process with the world. Since then, it's been in synagogues, in temples, in churches, in classrooms, in boardrooms, in circles and cycles around the world. We've taught visioning here many times. We've had visioning workshops. And in visioning, what I love about visioning is you can use this tool to ask yourself, what is Spirit's highest vision for my life? And listen, to have a one-on-one conversation with God. And that's what it is to me, because then God says something, and then I'm drawing a little picture, and then I say, oh, yeah, don't forget this. And he's like, yeah, that's right, baby. Right? That one-on-one conversation, yes. And this one, we're not so much just telling God as helping him, as listening to him. One who sees our very best, whether you call it God or your higher power or the universe. That which sees your very best and says, you are enough, just as you are. And freedom is your divine birthright. What'd the man say? He sang it to us how many times? Yes, yes, yes. To be able to contemplate what is Spirit's vision of freedom for humanity? Freedom for humanity. Clean air, clean water, someplace to live. Peace. Love. Yes, we gotta go a little higher, y'all. And stay there a little more often. Yes?
Yes,
yes. Love each other. Yes. The second question is, what must I become to empower this vision? See, it's already telling you that God can only do for you what God can do through you. So you ask the question, what must I become to empower this vision? And then you get to become it. Now, the third question is, what must be released. It's the time to let go. Surrender. Create some space for that vision to live, to be breathed into. Question 4. What must be embraced? And with an eager, open ear to hear and listen for the goodies coming your way. place where the edges get smoothed.
Yes.
What must be embraced.
Yes.
And living from that place.
Yes.
Embodying that. And question 5. Is there anything else for me to know at this time?
Yes.
And listen as God tells you. How you are loved, how you are cared for, how you are not alone, how you are divinely supported, how you are adored, how the grass just thinks you're the bomb.com and kind of perks up when you come out. You know? He does that. God does that for us. He, she, whatever you call it. But we, to be able to hear what God wants us to know. Oh my God! And that's the end. That's the end of the 5 steps. Isn't it beautiful? Yes. So that's your homework this week. To take that question, those 5 questions. If you didn't take notes, some people in here did. Try to find them after service. Don't be waiting for the, I'll wait till Tuesday till the talk come up. No. Now, while you're inspired, while you're inspired, ask yourself, what does freedom look like for all humanity? For all humanity. And then where do I fit in there, God? Oh my God, I got a place. That is my sacred prayer. That is my gift to you today. And I'm so feeling so good about it.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Martin Luther King, in his letter to Birmingham, he said, there was a time when the church was powerful. And I assert this is that time.
Yeah.
And we are that church.
Yeah. Yeah.
Let us take this into prayer, knowing that right where we are is holy ground, and that the word has already been spoken. The yes that leaps up from each of our hearts is met with a resounding yes by Mother, Father, God. We don't know if we're calling it forth or it's calling us forth, but we are willing to love. I give thanks for every person here, for each prayer in each heart. I give thanks for CSA. I give thanks to know that we are one. There's only one of us here. We put this new intention, this new vision of ourselves. We release it to the great law of life, knowing that from this moment forward, we are being shifted and changed and healed, restored, made new, transformed. So we let it be with joyful delight. We let it be. And so it is.